Chapter 6, we're going to read a familiar passage this morning and hopefully take maybe a different look at things from what you've looked at this before. But Matthew chapter 6, verses 5 through 13, Jesus is in the middle of his teachings on different topics. And this is one of the most famous and well-known teachings that we know of that Jesus told us about prayer. In fact, it's called the Lord's Prayer. And here's where it picks up. He says in verse 5. Actually, let's go before verse 5. He says in verse 1. Let's start in verse 1. Take heed that you do not your alms before men, to be seen of them. Otherwise, ye have no reward of your Father, which is in heaven. Therefore, when thou doest thine alms, do not sound a trumpet before thee, as the hypocrites do in the synagogues and in the streets, that they may have glory of men. Verily I say unto you, they have their reward. But when thou doest alms, let not thy left hand know what thy right hand doeth, that thine alms may be in secret, and thy Father, which seeth in secret himself, shall reward thee openly. And when thou prayest, thou shalt not be as the hypocrites are, for they love to pray, standing in the synagogues and in the corners of the streets, that they may be seen of men. Verily I say unto you, they have their reward. But thou, when thou prayest, enter into thy closet. And when thou hast shut thy door, pray to thy Father which is in secret, and thy Father which seeth in secret shall reward thee openly. But when ye pray, use not vain repetitions, as the heathen do, for they think that they shall be heard for their much speaking. Be not ye therefore like unto them, for your Father knoweth what things ye have need of before ye ask him. And after this manner therefore pray ye. Our Father, which art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done in earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. I'll leave the reading at that this morning. A message I've titled, Disciplines of the Devoted. And we'll look to this. Let's have a word of prayer as we do that. Lord, we thank you for what's gone on before us. We thank you that your love is never ending and that you are always good. That we can know that every day your mercy is new in our lives. And Lord, we pray that we might be looking for that mercy. And as we spend this time around your word, I pray that we might find what it means in our own lives to seek after your grace and your sustenance and your goodness for our lives each day. May we be seeking your face on a regular basis, and may we seek you and find you here today as we study your word together and try to examine your truth. We thank you for that opportunity now, and we ask it in Jesus' name. Amen. Disciplines of the devoted. You know, we think about the Lord's Prayer. How many of you came from a background where they used to recite the Lord's Prayer? Many came from that. You would say, our Father, thou art in heaven. You know it. So a lot of times we come from a background and we know from memory every word of the Lord's Prayer, right? Because it's something that we used to rehearse regularly. And we don't always do that so much in churches that we do today a lot of times. But sometimes you still do see that from time to time. And, it's been preached on a lot. The Lord's Prayer obviously has a lot in it. It's power-packed, and I'm not going to begin to try to examine it all today. But I want us to look at the context by which we see the Lord's Prayer presented to us. Because I think in it we find the reason and the mechanism by which we were given the Lord's Prayer in the first place. And that is, Jesus, as often was the case, was making a point for us, and oftentimes against the religious gatherings of the day. And this is where we were when we pick up in verse 5. He says, when thou prayest, thou shalt not be as the hypocrites are. Now, He doesn't actually say who they are, but he tells us in other passages who he thinks the hypocrites are, right? They're the Pharisees. They're the religious order. They're the scribes. They're those that had all of the religious trappings about them. They seemed to be doing the right thing. They gave of their tithes. They gave of their time. They knew the scripture. They memorized large portions of scripture. They were the upper echelon, if you will, of those that would, most people in society would say, these are the godly people that we need to look up to. And they would have a habit sometimes of going in the streets and praying in a public way, you know, and it would be almost like this was a, you know, I'm going to be magnanimous and share my love of God with all of you by this big public prayer that I'm going to go out and share. And, you know, by most of society's standards, until Jesus came and started calling them hypocrites and sepulchers and dead people, I mean, all these other names that he gave to them, they were revered. They were honored. They were loved by the people. They were looked at as the model person that they should all ultimately try to get to. And what does Jesus call them here? He calls them the hypocrites. And we answer the question, why does he call them that? Because exactly of why he calls them this time after time after time. Because the actions didn't match up with the heart. He knew that on the inside, as he told his disciples one time, you know, they're like empty sepulchers, right? Outside they're whitewashed, they look wonderful, but on the inside are dead men's bones. He says, their hearts are not with me. Their hearts are not devoted to me. They have all the trappings. They have all of the things in place to make them look like they love me. But on the inside, there's emptiness. There's deadness. There's no real connection with God on the inside. And you know, I worry about us today because I think a lot of times, I'm not saying we're like the hypocrites and the Pharisees, and I don't know that many of you probably have stood on the street corner to pray publicly. You know, the fact of the matter is, we can run into that same mindset where we have all the trappings, where we know how to live and act and have the right speech. We've cleaned up our mouth. We've cleaned up our actions. We don't drink and we don't chew and we don't go with people who do and all that kind of stuff. You know, we've got all of the right habits down maybe. We come to church, we give our tithes, we try to contribute, be a part of the different activities that are going on. But where's the inside? Do we ever stop to take time? Where is my real inner connection to God? Who in my heart, does God have me on the inside? Or am I just going through the religious motions like the Pharisees used to do? If we don't stop sometimes and examine who we are on the inside and what is our true devotion towards God, we will find ourselves maybe traveling down that religious road of life and finding at the end of the life that, hey, maybe we're saved, maybe we've accepted Christ, but God in the end says, you know, yes, I never had your heart. You get to heaven, but like we've said before, you build on that wood, hay, and stubble. You haven't built with the precious stones, with the gold, the things that will last, because I never really had your heart. We have emptiness on the inside. And so Jesus here talks about, in the course of understanding the Lord's Prayer, some specific disciplines of those that are truly devoted to Him. You know, we each need a time in our life, day by day, maybe more than once a day, where we are spending time with God, where we are separating ourselves to Him, to develop our relationship with Him, when our heart cries a need for Him, because we want to have that the relationship, that intimacy with God. And so we see here a set of principles that are laid out in this passage that tell us maybe some disciplines that can help us as we hope to have a greater devotion to God. And the first thing we see here in verses 5 and 6, he says, don't be as the hypocrites are. They love to pray standing in the synagogues and in the corners of the streets that they may be seen of men. Verily I say unto you, they have their reward. But thou, verse 6, when thou prayest, enter into thy closet. And when thou hast shut thy door, pray to thy Father, which is in secret. And thy Father, which is seeth in secret, shall reward thee openly. First thing we need to think about, if we're going to truly understand a heart's devotion towards God, is that we need a personal time with Him. We need a personal time when we cloister ourselves away, when we put ourselves in those prayer closet. Maybe it's a physical place where we have to go to get some peace and quiet, to get a moment where we can say, it's just about me and God. You know, oftentimes we know we live our faith, we're public about our faith. We say, oh, I'm here, I'm a Christian, I'm living out in front of everybody. But we neglect the personal time that we need with God. He says those people that are public, they're being seen of men. He said, but you enter into your closet. No one's going to see you there. He says, in fact, shut the door. Don't even allow the world's presence to be aware of what you're doing, because this has nothing to do with what the world is around you. It has everything to do with your one-on-one connection with the God of the universe, your devotion to Him. Shut the door, get yourself away from the world, and do it before Him. Spend that time with Him. God desires, we see this time and time again through Scripture, God desires an intimate and personal relationship with us. He wants us to be one-on-one with Him. And so often we neglect the joy that can bring to our lives. So often we don't do it because we don't have time, life's busy, the house is noisy, you know, whatever it is. We have all kinds of reasons. The day gets away from us. We don't have those habits built in where we spend that time one-on-one in a personal way with God to develop our connection with Him. We should desire that deep and personal connection with God. That's key for us having devotion to Him. So we need that personal time with God. But secondly, verses 7 and 8 tell us that we also need a practical time with God. Verse 7 says, when ye pray, use not vain repetitions as the heathen do, for they think that they shall be heard for their much speaking. Be not ye therefore like unto them, for your Father knoweth what things ye have need of before ye ask Him. Have a practical time. It says, don't use these vain repetitions. You know, I think this is one of the most ironic things. We asked this earlier. How many of you grew up in churches where you would say the Lord's Prayer every week? The verse before just said, don't use vain repetitions. But yet, this is probably one of the most vainly repeated prayers in all of Scripture. We just repeat it blindly, right? And Jesus just got done saying, this shouldn't be what it's about. It should be a personal, deep, you know, practical prayer that means something to you. And I'm not saying that the Lord's Prayer, if we recite it, sometimes it does mean something to us. But if it just becomes, I'm going to rotely say this prayer again, we've fallen into that same trap, haven't we? And you know, we do this all through life. Probably most of you pray before mealtimes. And it's, God bless our food. Amen. Or whatever it is, you know. And you probably followed into that rut there. It's the same things every meal. And God wants us to thank Him. I mean, we shouldn't stop doing that. But is it really speaking from your heart? Or is it just speaking from habit? We have to be careful about this. When we spend time with God and we say, okay, here's my prayer list, and I just run through it again. I'm here before God. I'm here. I'm saying the same words over and over again. We've got to be careful that we've got a heart connection with what we're saying. Again, it's all about God getting at our heart with this, right? We cloister ourselves away. We say, I want to have this one-on-one time. And then you know what? I'm just going to say the Lord's Prayer. And maybe sometimes that's all we can say. But the fact of the matter is, God wants us to pour out our heart to Him. And you can't do that in a practical way through words that you read from a page or a prayer that you've memorized. It has to be, God, here's what's on my heart. Here's my burden today. Somebody's sick. I've got children that I'm struggling with. I've got financial problems that I need your help with. God, here's who I am. Expose yourself before God. Allow yourself to be intimate with Him and share those heart burdens. Maybe heart burdens that are so deep and so part of who you are that maybe you haven't even shared them with other people. That's a connection with God. To say, I'm going to have this practical time when I pour out my heart to Him. Don't say just make it something that has no meaning or application. It can't just be like when we go to bed and now I lay me down to sleep and I pray the Lord. We know the words, right? We can say it in our sleep. I don't even know why we bother saying them sometimes. But we got to make sure it's a true practical prayer when we have that time with God. Psalm 4:4 just says this: commune with your own heart upon your bed and be still. When have we taken the time to just be still before God? And say, God, I don't even know what to say right now. But I'm going to just spend this time before you, knowing that you're here with me. That I'm here in this prayer closet. I put myself away from the cares of the world. And I don't even know what to say sometimes. That's what the psalmist said. Psalm 46:10 says, be still and know that I am God. You know that it's okay to have a time with God where you're just silent. Maybe you don't even know what to say. You just spend that time before Him in silence. Be still. Know that He is God. Feel His presence. Work for that connection that you need in your life. Don't just get through it. Okay, I did my prayer. I did my this. I did my that. I checked the list. Moving on. You know, it's not like you made your toast and your coffee in the morning and now you can get on with your day. No, it's got to be something that, maybe we don't have that much time every day, but take that time when you can. Get yourself pulled away from the cares of the world and develop that connection, the practical connection with God. Romans 8:26 tells us, when we do that, the Holy Spirit sometimes helps us when we need it. It says, the Spirit helps our infirmities, for we know not what we should pray for as we ought. Sometimes we don't know. And we just need that Holy Spirit in our life to intervene, to intercede, to help where we are deficient. Because oftentimes, we don't even know how to pray. But that makes it a practical time with God and a personal time with God. And then verse 9 brings it right down to where we've been talking about anyway. We need a prayerful time with God. Verse 9 says, after this manner, therefore, pray ye. You know, this should go without saying, but God wants us to talk to Him. God wants us to be in prayer with Him. And you say, but God knows everything. Well, yeah, He does. God knows my heart. Yeah, He does. God knows every hair in my head. Yeah, does. But does He still want you to talk to Him? Sure He does. Because how do you build a relationship with someone if you never talk to them? You know, I don't know how your marriage works, but at least in my home, if I spent a week without talking to my wife, she might think I was mad at her. I don't know. Maybe, maybe not. You know? You have to talk. You have to communicate in order to develop relationships, right? And sometimes maybe you have to hold your tongue, but nonetheless, you have to have meaningful communication with people in order to build relationships with them, right? God is no different. God wants us to talk to Him. He wants that relationship. He wants us to have that one-on-one connection. Again, He wants our heart. So we need a prayerful time with God. And you know what? When we spend our time and we say, I'm going to have time with devotions today, I'm going to have my quiet time with God, oftentimes, you know, honestly, it's probably easy sometimes. I'm going to read my chapter of Scripture. I'm going to read my daily bread. And I'm going to close the book and move on. And say, I did my thing. Because you know what? It's a lot easier just to read some stuff and move on. It's like reading the newspaper some days, right? But it's a lot more difficult for us to say, okay, God, I'm going to sit here and I'm going to pray. And I'm going to pray not for the sake of other people, but for the sake of me, my relationship with You. It's a command. We are to pray, to be prayerful with God. Spend this time communicating our heart with Him. And then we see, as part of this time, when we spend this quiet time with him, when we work to have this devotion towards him, what do we see next? He says in verse 9 and 10, he says, after this manner, therefore, pray ye, our Father, which art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth, in earth, as it is in heaven. Next principle I think we see here from this passage is that we need a praise-filled time with God. We need a time when we just praise him, thank him for who he is and what he's done. You see what the very beginning of the prayer is about? Hallowed be thy name. We don't tend to use those words very much anymore. But what's the prayer's intent here? God, you're holy. God, you're perfect. God, you're sovereign. Hallowed be your name. Let you get the glory in my life, in the things that I'm doing. Praise him for who he is. Praise him for his holiness. Remind yourself by saying that of your lack of holiness. Because you know it's all too often when we don't spend time with God, the better we sometimes think we are. Right? Isn't that where the Pharisees were at? They didn't have that heart connection. The more stuff they did, the more ways they contributed, the more public prayers that they presented to people, the more they thought about themselves. You know, I'm doing all right. I got my act together. I'm all right here. And you know, we can fall into that same trap. I went to church this week. I gave my tithe. I did this. I did that. I got my act together. But you know what? When we concentrate and praise God for his holiness, for his perfection, we realize how much our holiness doesn't need that. We praise God for his holiness because it gives him glory and it puts us where we need to be positionally before him. Hallowed be thy name, it says. Thy kingdom come. Praise and acknowledge the fact that, God, you're in control. Your kingdom is going to come someday. There is going to be a day when your authority will not be denied by anyone. His kingdom is coming. Remind yourself of that and remind him that you have faith in the fact that he is doing this, that he will do what he has promised to do. In other words, you're telling God, God, you're faithful. God, let your kingdom come. Because you know what? You told us in the scripture that Jesus is coming back. You told us in scripture that one day all the wrongs will be righted again. And you know what? I have faith in that promise because you're a God that's faithful. I can praise you for that fact. And maybe you can think about some things in your own life. It says, God, you've been faithful in this area. You've been faithful in that area. Praise him for those things. Recognize his goodness in your life. And then finally, he says, thy will be done in earth as it is in heaven. Praise him for his perfect plans, for his perfect will. You know, God has our best interest at heart. Sometimes we question that. Sometimes we don't understand that. If you were in Sunday school this morning and you heard about the story of Noah, Noah probably questioned whether God had, you know, any sense about this when he told them to build a giant boat and float through a flood that they've never seen before. You know, it took a lot of blind faith. Sometimes we can't understand the logic behind who God is and what he does. But you know what? We can have faith in the fact that no matter what he does, it's always for our good. It's like the song we just sang. You are always good. All the time. Even in circumstances when I don't understand, what does Paul say? Count it all joy when you fall into diverse temptations. He says, because why can I count it joy? Because I know God's still in those things. God's going to show me through this trial. He's got something in this. And I can have faith in the fact, even when bad times happen, that God's good. Thy will be done. Praise him for his sovereignty, that nothing happens by chance. Look to his will and his sovereignty for your own life. How often do we want to have control, right? When you say to God, God, let your will be done, what are we saying? Hey, I'm relinquishing control here. I'm not going to try to control my own life. I'm not going to make my own decisions. I'm going to submit to your will in my life. I'm going to do what you've called me to do. And I want you to show me. You know, sometimes if you put your life before God in that way, you may find God calls you to do great and mighty things that you didn't even have a mind for. But we have to submit our will to His. Say, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. So we see our time with God should be personal, practical, prayerful, praise-filled. And then in verse 11, we start to see some things that we should be looking to gain from our time with God. And in verse 11, we see a simple request. Give us this day our daily bread. Give us this day our daily bread. We should seek provision from God. Seek provision from Him. How is He going to provide for me today? You know, there's a number of things about this statement and this way of thinking that's really hard for us as humans, isn't it? Because we want to say, God, show me the plan for the next year. Show me that I'm going to have enough in my retirement account when the day comes for me to clock out for the last time. Show me, Lord, that this and this is all going to line up the right way. No, that's not what it says. It says, God, give me what I need for today. Give me the strength I need for today. Provide for my needs today. And you know, He will show Himself faithful. The Bible says He shows His mercies are new every morning. That means we wake up and we look for new mercies. New grace for today. New strength. New provision every day. That's the model that we saw in the Old Testament, right? Remember the children of Israel wandered around through the wilderness every day. What did they have to do? Go out and gather up manna. They had to gather up their food. God says, hey, I'm not giving you food for the next day. Well, unless it's the Sabbath, then you can gather an extra day. But other than that, He says, I'm only giving you enough for today. And tomorrow, you're going to have to walk out the door and in faith know that I'm going to have something there to provide for your needs. How often do we do that in our lives? How often do we get up in the morning and say, God, how are you going to provide for my needs today? I'm going to have faith in what you can do for me. I'm going to have faith that you can give me the daily bread that I need. Sometimes that's physical bread. Maybe we need that. Sometimes it's something we need spiritually, right? Sometimes it's something we need sustenance in our life, emotional support. You know, maybe it's just physical strength that we're lacking. Maybe it's the sickness that we're going through. We need provision in all these areas, our health needs. Sometimes we have a heartache that's burdening us. See, I just need strength to get through this heartache today. Provide for me. That's what you're saying to God when you ask Him to give us this daily bread. And this really intersects with what we typically think of when I say we need to go do our devotions every day. What do we think of? I need to read my Bible, right? I need to read a devotional book. I need to have something. Because you know what? God's Word says it is the bread of life. It is the bread that we partake of. It's something that we absorb into our life, that it lodges into our mind and it transforms us and it gives us the strength that we need, because God's truth will never return void. That's why we need to be in His Word every day, because He wants us to be provided for. And some people say, and I'm all for this. Somebody say, well, I'm gonna, you know, make a commitment every year to read through my Bible every year. And I think that's great. If you can do that, that's a great goal to have. But I also know that sometimes we just maybe need a snippet. We just need to take one verse and meditate on it and think about it and allow it to settle in on us and allow its truths to penetrate us and allow it to change us in some way. I like what C.H. Spurgeon has to say about this. He says, some people like to read so many chapters every day. I would not dissuade them from the practice, but I would rather let my soul soak in a half dozen verses all day than rinse my hand in several chapters. Oh, to be bathed in a text of Scripture and to let it be sucked up into your very soul till it saturates your heart. Set your heart upon God's Word. Let your whole nature be plunged into it as a cloth into a dye. Spurgeon always had a way with words. But isn't that what we should be doing? soaking up God's word like a sponge into our life, allowing it to penetrate us. Take that personal time when we've locked ourselves away, we've put the world aside, we said, God, I want to have my heart in tune with yours today. And I know it's going to require some time of prayer, it's going to require personal, you know, exposing myself, but it's also going to mean that you're going to provide for me. You're going to give me some of your word that sustains me for today. Give us our daily bread. Ask God for that. Seek provision. He wants to give it to us day by day. Then we see in verse 12, we see another facet of our devotional time. And he says, forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. So we not only seek provision from God, we also need to seek some pardon from God. We seek pardon from Him, don't we? You know, how do we expect to have a right relationship with God when we don't have right relationships with other people? When we're knowingly living in a way that is an affront to what God's showed us. You know, sometimes we just go about and let our sins continue to, you know, drag along behind us wherever we go. God says, hey, you've got to get your heart right before me. You've got to seek forgiveness. Seek forgiveness from me, and also seek forgiveness with other people. Because there might be people that you don't have the relationship you need to have. And maybe it's because bitterness has built up in your life. Maybe it's because you've been unwilling to forgive. Maybe it's because God's shown you something that you've done to wrong someone, and you've said, I'm not willing. They're going to have to come to me. And then we say, well, why is my relationship with God suffering? Well, maybe our heart's too hard. Maybe we need to get rid of the bitterness. Maybe we need to allow forgiveness to enter into our heart. Maybe we need to allow God to come and say, my grace is going to let you say, when I confess my sins, I will be faithful and just to forgive you my sins. We need to latch hold of that truth. But you know, when we seek pardon from God or pardon from other people, it takes something that a lot of us need a lot more of. Humility. Right? Takes humility on our lives, because it's hard to go to someone and say, I was wrong. It's hard to go to someone and say, you know, I've been bitter. It's hard to go to someone and say, you know, God showed me something that maybe you took the wrong way, and maybe I meant the wrong way, or whatever it may be, and I'm sorry. And I'm going to change. I'm going to be different. Because God's shown something to me, and I can't let this problem between us affect my relationship with God, because it's too important. It takes humility to seek pardon. So we need to keep short accounts with God. We need to stand before God as forgiven, but still seek His forgiveness every day, because that's how it works with everyone. How many people do we need to see and ask some forgiveness for? Then finally, we have one last idea that Jesus gives us in this Lord's Prayer. He says this in verse 13. He says, lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. Final thought here that I think Jesus leaves with us is we need to seek power from God. Power from God. In what ways? Well, first of all, he says, lead us not into temptation. You know, temptations oftentimes are only temptations because we don't have the power to face them. Right? Why do we fall into temptations? Because God's not big enough? No, because we're weak. Because our flesh is weak. Because we see the attractiveness of the temptation. We see the sin. We see that forbidden fruit in front of us, and we say, I can't resist that. But you know what the Bible says? It says, when you see those temptations, don't try to rest in your own willpower to get through it. Rest in God's power. He says, you can have this power from God. He says, lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. God wants to deliver you from these temptations. He wants to deliver you from the evil that would overtake your life if you were trying to live it under your own power and under your own strength. We need the power of God to face temptations in our life. And we need power against that evil that will be against us. And we need to recognize, no matter how we may think we have it all together, that it's never going to be enough to face all of the barrage of problems and issues and temptations and sins that are going to try to envelop us and quench our light each day. We need power from God. And we need to dedicate that whatever we do, whatever result happens in our life, we're going to give him the glory for his intervention. He says, thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory. God gets the glory forever. Amen. You know, there's a day when we will stand before God. We will be in heaven with him. And you know what we will be spending our time doing? Singing his praise. Giving him glory. Wouldn't it be good if we get used to doing that while we're here on earth? Wouldn't it be good if we got our practice in now so we were like, I don't know how to do this, Lord. I'm sure, don't worry, I think we're going to get some practice up there too. But nonetheless, how often do we take that time to let God capture our heart? How often do we create disciplines in our life that create that intimate connection that God wants to have with us? How often do we lack God's power? Do we fall victim to temptations? Do we deal with bitterness and anger and unforgiveness in our life because we just haven't been in communion with God? We need that in our lives. It's critical. So this is not just putting a guilt trip on us. It's not what this is about. We all know when we think about our daily walk with God and what we do with a quiet time with him and how we are doing with our devotions and how we are doing with reading our Bible, probably all of us, I'm not going to ask for hands, say, I've fallen short. Because I just know that that's true. It's so common. And I think that's why we are such a powerless group of Christians in the country that we live in today. Because we don't have that direct communion with God. But we cannot let our past failings become an excuse for who we are today and who we're going to become. There's always today to start new. There's always a new year that comes around. A lot of times you get these types of messages around the new year. We're going to make a new year's resolution. I'm going to read my Bible this year. Well, good. Let's get through January. January 2nd, okay? Whatever, you know. You know, whatever it takes, I don't know, but you gotta make some decisions. And you know, recognize that no matter what you do to create this time and to create these disciplines in your life, recognize that it doesn't make God love you more. God already loves you as much as he can love you. His love is never ending. And it's not dependent on our actions. God loves you. And he doesn't love you less if you've failed in this area. You can get back up on your feet and you can say, God, I messed up again. And you know what? 1 John 1:9 still applies. He's faithful and just to forgive us our sins. It cleanses from unrighteousness. And we can say, I failed. I'm going to get up again, Lord. Help me today. Give me the daily bread I need today. And then tomorrow do the same thing. Keep that habit going in your life. And you know what? You will find that if you develop this heart communion, this one-on-one intimate relationship with God, you will be the one that's blessed beyond measure. You will be the one that finds power for every day. You will be one that can see above the circumstances of life. You will be the one that ultimately is able to glorify God with your mouth and your actions and all that you are, your very being. And that's what God wants for us, right? We love Jesus Christ. He died for us. We know that we're saved. If we know that we're born again, we should be wanting to glorify him. And there's no better way to do it than to create that relationship with God that he wants to have with us. So I hope that's an encouragement to you this morning. Let's bow our heads together. Just take a moment right now to be quiet before the Lord, between you and him. Maybe there's something here that's struck in your mind and in your heart. An area where you've fallen short. An area where you need to get back up, dust off the problems that have prevented you from doing the right thing and make a new start at things. Tell that to the Lord right now. He loves you. He wants to be in communion with you. Lord, I pray for our failings. They've been many. I pray for those maybe that even in their own quiet moment just now have made a renewed decision to commitment to be in your word, to be in prayer, to develop a heart for you each day. May we be disciplined in our devotion for you. May we put these things into practice each day. May you help us as we make these commitments to follow through with them for day after day, year after year, so that we will ultimately be able to give you the glory for all that's done and said in our lives. We thank you for it in Jesus' name.